Here comes a roly-poly man, he's singing songs of love.
Geology, geology, geology. This is Daniel Minizini, your inquisitive geologist here at KPFT HD2 channel. Welcome everybody to Houston in the beautiful KPFT headquarters in the community radio for all of you that love earth sciences. And here we are to connect the earth sciences to society at large. Today we're going to talk about the history of the information in a very specific part of the geology, the petroleum geology. Today we have with us Francesco Gerali. He's a visiting scholar at the IEEE, which is the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers. So he's in the History Center in Hoboken, in New Jersey. Hi, Francesco. Are you there with us?
Hello. Hello, Daniel. How are you doing?
We're doing very fine here in Houston. How is it going over there in New Jersey? Are you overlooking on Manhattan?
We are doing very well. We are looking at Manhattan, and we had some pretty inclement weather in past days, but finally it's time for some sun, and I'm very glad to be here with you this evening to speak about some oil, petroleum in history.
Very well. So I know you're doing a project on the popular oil, the contributions on the oil and gas industry, history for the engineering and the technology history. So how does it come that you are putting together the history of petroleum geology?
Well, basically here I'm working to the history of technology and engineering wiki project. I'm the provider, the supplier, let's say, for content related to the history of technology and science in the oil industry. So I'm developing in about 25 entries on the history of the oil industry in a wiki style. So I'm taking reference from several primary and secondary sources and writing about bibliographies of early scientists in the oil industry, like Sir Boverton Redwood from England, writing about early oil technology, like the ECHNA, a system for manual drilling used in Romania. I will write about early Japanese oil technology in the 19th century.
Francesco, where are we going to find these terminologies and facts that you're going to put together in a wiki style? So you're publishing this online, I guess, at some point.
Exactly. This will be a completely open source free knowledge. On a hand written, I'm required to write this content in a wiki style, but the contents provided will be referred, and most important, people can write freely, very interesting, I hope, very interesting knowledge on the old know-how and practice in the early oil industry in the 19th century.
Francesco, who do you think is going to benefit from your work? Who is going to use and consume what you produce?
Well, considering that we are writing in a wiki style, our aim is to provide a service to a wide spectrum of people, a wider audience. I mean, I will be very happy if what I'm writing will provide knowledge and information, data to students from high school, undergrad level, graduate level. And since I'm providing quite a specific content on the early technology using primary sources, I do hope that this research can be appreciated also by historians at academic level And for sure, the enthusiasts, the many, many enthusiasts in history that are working, that are professionals in the petroleum industry setting.
So what is your point of view? And you, Francesco, are an historian.
Correct.
What do you think that the geologists, they think about the history of their own discipline? Are they aware of that history? They don't care, or they love it? What do you think about it?
In line of principle, many of them love them. Let's remember that in the U.S., since probably more than 30 years, well, 40 years, there is a learned society, the Earth Science History Society. At international level, there is the INIGEO, the International Commission on the History of Geological Science. Then there is an History Committee, an History Chapter from the Geological Society of America. There is also the same kind of chapter from the American Association of Petroleum Geologists. There are other minor, let's say, society, union of professionals in the industry that are interested in history, for sure.
All right, so let's start talking about the history of the information of petroleum geologists. Where do we start from?
Well, I would like to start to pay some attention to the pre-industrial moment, because it's important to understand the development of the understanding of the knowledge on oil in the scientific technical literature. And let me also say that the geology will be not the exclusive protagonist. Oil industry is an integrated chain that involves geology, engineering, chemistry. If I'm allowed, I would like to call science logistic. The science, the logistic, I think, is a science, an important science, transportation, how to move oil, petroleum. But now let me start from the late 16th century, because the main question at the beginning of between the 16th and 17th century was still, what is it, oil? I mean, how many oils we have? What is that black matter? We have a language to define oil, or we still need the lingua franca?
What is the lingua franca?
A lingua franca, we can say, a universal code, a standard, a vocabulary, a controlled vocabulary that is commonly accepted between all the scholars, all the professionals. Because we have to understand that oil, from this moment, let's say, the late 16th century, until the early 19th century, was a kind of Babylon in terms of, let's say, terminology to refer to that or another subject related in the oil industry, etc. Just let me start with what was oil? Well, basically, the only word that could define oil in the early literature was bitumen. Bitumen was a large umbrella including liquid, dense, semi-solid, and solid petroleum. Other names were naphtha, petroleum, bitumen, pitch, tar, asphaltum. But the point is that all these substances needed to be still understood and discovered. For example, we found many general, let's say, atlas of science where we can find oil described about its utilization, waterproofing, fuel for lamps, medications, materials for sculpture, and whatever else.
And this is in the 1500s?
1500, 1600, and still in the 1700s. I make you an example. The first early technological mention of oil regarded the refining and was written by Georg Agricola in his iconic De Re Metallica. And we found an interesting explanation about the early refining per descendum.
I see. Agricola is a very important piece. We also use it as the very first author talking about sedimentology and mudstones.
Correct, correct, correct. Coming back about geology, you will ask me probably, Francesco, speaking about a book of oil geology, well, I will give you a big disappointment because was not exactly known the idea of geology itself, and oil was something still something of to be deciphered. But we find the works like Pierre Bellon, that was a botanist, a zoologist, an anatomist, that was in France. We find in Italy the works of Pietro Andrea Mattioli, and then other works that are like large, big encyclopedia on the natural science, on the natural philosophy, where oil was described. You could find description of the soils where oil was found and the several utilizations. So this was a part of the knowledge. But what about, again, how we can define oil? How we can understand oil if we don't even have a concept, if we are not agree about the terminology? Well, an example is given by Andrea Libavius in his Singularium, the third volume. There is the Tabulorum Librorum, in which explains, presents about 35 different names to describe oil. 35 different names, and we are in 1601.
And when you say oil in 1601, do you mean, or did he mean, oil as we conceive it today, or oil was at that point also vegetal oil?
Very good question. No, no, no. We mean our oil, petroleum. We need to tell very well that. If we want to speak about oils in general, we are going to face a Babylon, and I tell you why very briefly, very briefly. Oils made with animal fats were the castor oil, spermaceti or train oil, the blubber oil, chrysalides, tallow, and some others. About the vegetal world, we find the rapeseed oil, the beech oil, olive oil, linen oil, castor oil, palm oil, canthine, turpentine. So, basically, referring to oil, especially in the environment of the greases and the lamp oils for illumination, we use the term oil. About petroleum, our petroleum, we have to use the term bitumen. Bitumen.
Do you know where the etymology of bitumen comes from, or why they call it bitumen?
Bitumen comes from the Latin, and there is a long history also about the etymology of the word oil. Actually, there is a very wonderful chart made by two Italian oil geologists, Dr. Sella and Dr. Novelli, where they prepared a chart along about 6 pages with an interesting history of the development of the etymology of words like naphtha, naftun, bitumen, petroleum, rock oil, oleum petronicum. I mean, we can dive in the terminology for hours. But my point is that what we call today petroleum, this big umbrella, in the past was something still foggy, into the clouds. I mean, we can find probably 5 up to 10 different names to define, to call what today the science calls tar, for example. Because oil was not known, the composition was known, the physical aspect in terms of viscosity. It was dense, less dense, sticky, solid, was washy. So oil was, in this literature, in this early literature, was simply described as it appeared in the natural form.
And Francesco, why do you think people of the past, in the 1600s, they wrote about petroleum? Because it's probably maybe 100, 150 years that we have the press after Gutenberg. Books are very rare. People, they generally don't read. So what is the goal of writing and informing the readers of that time about petroleum?
Good question. Oil was, in line of principle, a raw substance of secondary importance, with little weight in the markets of oil and little utilized in the society, but was a product of the earth. Therefore, alchemists, natural philosophers, physicians, and then chemists were describing, writing about oil in these large, huge books, encyclopedia, together with the many other objects, things of the nature. I mean, you can find oil in the same book you find described iron, copper, honey. There are encyclopedias of many volumes where you can find one volume of on flora, a volume on fauna, another volume on mineral waters, another chart, another part on flammable substances. And oil was simply, especially bitumen, pitch, and tar, the three more common, and naphtha, the very light fraction, was into these books. Oil was into these books like a common pedestrian walking in a crowded way with thousands and thousands of persons.
Interesting. I'm intrigued by the relationship you made between petroleum and the natural philosopher, you said. In which sense the natural philosopher, and I highlight philosopher, is linked with the petroleum?
The natural philosopher is a kind of big name, big category in the history of science that can include apothecaries, botanists, physicians, zoologists, alchemists. Natural philosopher is the scientist that was working on the things of the nature before the beginning of the specialization, before the definition of a geologist, of a paleontologist, before the beginning of the real chemistry, therefore the professionalization of the figure of the chemist. Yeah. The natural philosopher was someone writing discourses less or more scientific on the objects present in the nature. Just let me say that, and then I would like to move forward because there is a lot to say. For example, you find oil described in the book of Pierre Pomé, a French, that was basically a botanist. Oil, petroleum, the white petroleum, that was naphtha, described in the book Histoire Générale des Drogues, General History of the Drugs, for example. You can find also, let's not forget, also books, especially books related to geography, talking about gas. We have the story of the burning fountain from Grenoble, where the description of this burning fountain in the area of Grenoble became the reason of writing the first wide witnessing on the natural effusion in France, of the natural effusions of gases, of gas seepages. And there are very interesting description, obviously, in the terminology of the time, with the poor knowledge of oil and gases of that time. But moving forward, oil at some point started to get more attention. When?
Where are you bringing us now? Where do we go? Which century?
Now we are in exactly in 1625. We are in Alsace, in the time of French-German area in Middle Europe, where an apothecary, Johannes Volk, wrote in the description of the now heart balsam petroleum and sulfagat stone, and a very long title, blah, 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 this is probably the first description written in fractur, in old German fractur character, about the utilization of oil, about the refining of oil, about its physical properties. I made some research about this book. Are recorded just 6 copies all around the world, and one is here in the United States, the History of Science Collection of the University of Oklahoma, another one is in Dresden. So this is the very first rare importance witnessing of oil discussed as oil and as a commercial substance. It's a pamphlet of about 35 pages, allow me a joke, completely soaked of petroleum.
In which year was written?
Was written in 1625 by Johannes Volk. Another important, let's move forward a century, 1734, Johann Theophil Oeffel. In the same area, he wrote about, I read in Latin, the Historia Balsami Mineralis Alsaticis, Petrolei, Valli Santi, Lamperti, etc., etc., etc. Basically, Hoeffel, in 1734, wrote that probably refining would be the key for a wider utilization of the bitumens. Here is a very breakthrough idea in the early history of petroleum. Because for the first time, this guy, Hoeffel, not an amatorial, proposed the idea that the better oil is refined, the more can be utilized and can be useful in the society.
In which sense? The society of that time, how they wanted to use the petroleum or the refined petroleum?
Well, I say that the most valuable fraction of petroleum in the world of the petroleums was naphtha. Naphtha was the lighter one, the lighter fraction. The one with the lower specific gravity. I mean, it was the first quality one. And why was the first quality one? Because it was possible to use it raw for illumination, and obtaining a very good bright flame. It was so pure as an alcoholic substance, let's say that, that was used as medication. People was drinking oil and using oil over a scarf and the wounds in the skin. Was used by surgeons. So, science at some point understood that the other oils, let's call them black oils, were basically a kind of oil that needed to be refined, to be boiled, cooked, before to obtain a sort of naphtha. So the idea was basically was very simple. If the natural bright, colored, and light naphtha was used a lot and was very valuable, very expensive, if we find a way to produce, to distill, let's say, artificial naphtha from black petroleum, we can start a big business. This was the idea that unfortunately fallen a bit in the dark of UN Theophile Oeffel in 1734. His treatise has a very, very limited diffusion and remained forgotten. Let's go ahead. Let's go forward. Still in the 18th century, there was finally the fracture between alchemy and chemistry. There was the gradual passing of the torch from the natural philosopher to the scientist. The scientist working in a definite field of investigation or discipline. And we find finally works like the ones of Kirwan, other works from other scientists like Daniel Tilas in Sweden, Kirwan, sorry, was from Ireland. We find the Dictionary of Chemistry, we find the Manual of Mineralogy. We find Kirwan that in 1796 wrote of the composition and the proportion of carbon in bitumens and mineral coal, and make a proposal for analysis of the chemical composition of bitumens for economic purposes. Another important step in the history, now I can use the word hydrocarbons. Why? Faraday. Michael Faraday, that all we know for other researchers in the history of science and technology. But Michael Faraday wrote in 1825 in the Philosophical Transaction of the Royal Society of London, issue 115, on the new compounds of carbon and hydrogen, and on certain other products obtained during the decomposition of oil by heat.
So may we say that Faraday was one of the first ones introducing this terminology of hydrocarbon?
Of hydrocarbon, correct. Michael Faraday, 1825. You don't know how many years it costed me to find this reference. But yes, the earlier, the mention of carbon as a composition in bitumen, we find that already in Kirwan in 1796. It was presented earlier, but Kirwan wrote a treatise on that.
So when now we move from the 18th to the 19th century, also the history of information moves from Europe to North America?
It will start very, very soon, and now we'll touch this topic. So in this moment, mainly, correct, good observation, history of the information on the knowledge on oil until the mid of the 19th century, so we are now in the 19th century, is mostly, a European matter. When we switch with which in the moment that oil started to be considered an illuminant. The spark came from Europe, from Lukasiewski in the Austro-Hungarian Galicia, today Poland. James Young from Scotland, people that discovered how petroleum could be slowly refined into an illuminant. Then we have the British Canadian, but professionally developed in New York, Abraham Gessner, chemist and geologist. Then we find in this period many other countries that contributed to the knowledge of oil: Germany, France, Italy, Poland, Austria, Sweden, Canada, Scotland, and finally United States. And let me quote Thackeray, 1970. Thought does not respect national frontiers, yet scientific ideas are far from be stateless citizens. The knowledge of oil was flying very well to the United States, and in the moment that oil started to be considered a feedstock for the industry, we have finally the explosion of the oil literature in the United States. What was the spark, Daniel? The spark was the report written in 1855 by Benjamin Silliman Jr., titled Rock Oil or Petroleum from the Venango County. And this moment is when oil finds momentum, because in this short report there is the key for the early concept of modern concept of we need to refine oil to get a fuel lamp. After that, what started, Daniel? Started the modern oil industry, because finally, let's say a big word, may I use a big word, the humankind discovered that the refined petroleum, following the principle expressed by Benjamin Silliman Jr., petroleum was providing a liquid that was giving, was yielding a longer burning flame, stability of the flame, a best radiated intensity of the light, was more practical to use, less residues of combustion, and was a very lower cost, and was very widely available, cheap and abundant, the key of the energy after in the second half of the 19th century, the key of the development of cheap and abundant energy for everyone. So,
Francesco, and the history of this information,
sure.
Is it biased because of the source of the document, or other parts of the world, they don't really know about petroleum, thinking about Asia or Africa or South America?
Well, they knew, not all the world, but we can say that Asia and India, Asia and Latin America already in the 1870s were well aware of oil and its potential. But the literature was a good 90% for sure from United States, Canada, and Europe. Yes. We need to explore oil, Daniel. So we have to establish companies. Good. And when you establish a company, what you do? You advertise that you are opening a new company with a prospectus, because you look for investor, you need money. So in the history of information of oil, where you can find the information, we find a very interesting form, the prospectus, the company prospectus, where you can find economic evaluation of the region, early geological studies, technical feasibility of the construction of the derricks in the field, notes on logistics, chemical analysis of oils, and so on. And why that, Daniel? Because you have to give a lot of oil, petroleum information to the investor, because the investor is the gambler looking to give you money, basically on a blind base. So these prospectors, especially for the historians today, but already at the time, were a huge, unexpected source of information of the potential oil fields in the world. I have in front of me, for example, the oil prospectus of the Wallachian Petroleum Company in Romania. I have the one in front of me, a copy, obviously. I would like to have the original. A copy of the Zante Petroleum Company from England looking to work in the island of Zacintos. And we have important names in these reports of scientists of the time. Why? Because at that time was the name of the scientist, of the chemist, of the geologist writing that report was the guarantee, was the reference, was the important. Because that scientist, that important scientist, had the reputation. So what we have finally? We have the need for the oil industry to find scientists with a reputation to study oil. Oil business called first quality professionals since the beginning. We need to remember that, Daniel. Let me move forward. We find an explosion of literature, other reports on the same note I told earlier. Petroleum in Mexico by John Randolph from New York. There was a huge mining engineer working in coal mines in Mexico and the United States that was invited to study oil in Mexico in 1883. We have books on technical, practical informations like the 1865 Le Pétrole of Émile Soulier and Hippocrates Odin. It was a kind of mini encyclopedia where you can find information of deposits, way of exploration, way of chemical treatment, way of transportations. Again, we find oil on the important academic literature like the American Philosophical Society Transaction. And then Daniel, going along the 80s and the 90s of the 19th century, we start to find specific, very specific focused books on the industry that are starting to dig more into the technology and the geology. There are several titles that I can mention. One of them, the most famous, is Petroleum from Boverton Redwood. The first edition was printed in 1896 and the last edition in 1926. Just to give you an idea of the magnitude of a book like that. In 30 years, 5 editions, and is a book in 3 volumes of about 700 pages each. A lot of paper, a lot of paper. We find finally the new gender, a new kind of publication on oil. We find the handbook. The Handbook of Petroleum for the Inspectors. We find the Petroleum Technology Pocketbook. And we start to find very technical, practical literature for the oil technologist, or, allow me to say, the guy that today we would call the oil engineer. Now, just let me say that finally oil, we find oil also in the government literature. I have in front of me, for example, a copy of the official reports of the Mineral Resource Office of the United States, United States, 1888. We find another important monographic volume, I don't remember how many hundreds of pages, Production Technology and Uses of Petroleum and Its Products, from Peckham. This is a must in the early government literature of oil, because basically these kind of reports were provided by the several bureaus to the Congress, to the Senate. I mean, this is the official literature that helped in the future the, let's say, the U.S. legislator to put an eye on the world of petroleum and understand what was oil. So we find then oil more and more mentioned and described also in the, let's say, commerce literature. Here in front of me, for example, I have a note of the, from the House of Representatives, a letter of the Secretary of State about the commercial relations of the United States with the foreigner countries, and in the, I have several numbers, several issues, in the issue of 1862, the word petroleum occurred 7 times. In the issue of 1863, 17 times. In the issue of 1894, 230 times. Oil was a subject in this communication from the Secretary of State, was a subject of business, science, technology, and trade. Oil started to be in all the kind of literature. What we are missing, Daniel, I talked about books, I talked about official reports, government documents. We are missing the journal, like the Oil and Gas Journal, the Today Oil and Gas Journal, or the British, the early British, the Petroleum Review. And here we are between 1899 and 1902. There is an interesting mention of the importance of the news journal and the reason why they started to be printed, and they were very expensive to print, and many of them were sort of weekly issues. So I'm not speaking about monthly or year issue. We're speaking about a series of weekly issues. The idea of this journal came from the need of the petroleum in professionals for new, reliable, and updated information on the oil markets. Basically, the editor of the Petroleum Review, a journal born in 1899 in Great Britain, was born because an oil professional involved in, actually was in oil logistics and oil chemistry, found out that the oil world, the petroleum sector, was now too large, too expanded, too hungry of information to depend just from scattered books and information from newspapers, general newspapers, like, I don't know, the Boston Globe, the New York Times, or financial newspapers. No. He said, this guy basically stated that this journal, this Petroleum Review, come out, is coming out to provide to the oil professional of the globe only specific information about the oil industry. And we find early accounts of about oil in Romania, oil in Burma, oil in the Caucasus, the explosion of the several fields in the United States, incredible accounts on the oil boom in Texas in 1901, that for the historians, these issues, all these collections of weekly journals are a pit of memories, a pit of original primary information. So, resuming, Daniel, in England, the most developed one was the Petroleum Industrial and Technical Review, and in the United States, the famous and still today in publishing, the Oil and Gas Journal. And the same people that developed in England the Petroleum Review, exactly 119 years ago, proposed, organized the first International Petroleum Congress in Paris, France, 1900. The second was in Liège, Belgium, 1905. The third was in Bucharest, Romania, 1907. The fourth was in Lvov, Austro-Hungarian Empire, today Ukraine, in 1910. In those years, the first four international congresses were a refinery of information, of updated news, science and technology, not a coincidence, held also in Romania and the Austro-Hungarian Empire, very oil country at the top of the list at the time. So, like today, we find the same connection, that the first information, fresh information is found in congresses, in symposium. And not a coincidence that after a hiatus of about 20 years, in 1933 was finally refounded the World Petroleum Congress. And if you have a dive on the digital library, One Petro, you will find that many interesting publications, many interesting notions, knowledge on science and technology on oil are the proceedings of the World Oil Congress. Another important aspect, Daniel, well, oil, as we know, probably we highlighted in one of our previous oil chats in radio, oil with the First World War became a strategic military political feedstock. Oil in that moment became something of so important that we have documents, public sources, from the Senate, the 67th Congress, second session, document 191. The Naval Petroleum Reserve number 3 of Wyoming. Letter from the Secretary of the Interior, exactly, to the Secretary of the Navy, 1922. 1922, oil was so strategic that we find the Navy, the United States Navy, was owner, producer, refiner, and was piling stocks of refined petroleum to be used exclusively on the war vessels. So oil was so strategic, and we find in this literature cross-reference information about geology, military utilization, that are very interesting under many aspects. Why we find oil very strategic, when again? I can make an example. We know very well that in the Second World War was probably a war where oil was more relevant than in the first. when I had the lucky chance to dive into the papers of Everett Lead Goller at the De Goller Collection of the Southern Methodist University, I found many documents declassified, obviously, from the years where De Goller was an official consultant for the Secretary of the Defense. I found a booklet that at the time was classified, was dated 1943. This book listed all the oil fields and the production of oil, petroleum, of the, at the time, enemy countries. I mean, the government of the United States in 1953 had the full knowledge of how many oil and where and what quality was produced by the, at the time, enemies country like Germany, Italy, and Japan.
So, Francesco, you are ready to conclude this long path of history of the information on oil and gas. What else do you want to tell us in order to reach this last decades and conclude with a historiographical reflection on the relationship between information in the past and information today?
Well, Daniel, actually, this is a very pivotal topic, because today data and information in the oil industry is a hot topic. Let's just mention a couple of keywords, like the new profession or the profession of the future, the data scientist. We can mention another important word, like cybersecurity. We know that in 1927 started the age of the electrical locks with the experiment, the successful experiment of Schlumberger in Pechelbronn. Not a coincidence, the same area where published Hofen and Volk a few centuries earlier. At that time, the electric log was basically the only source of information, the main one, and the electrical log was just a piece of paper long 4 inches. Before the famous ages of Schlumberger, and let's also remember that Schlumberger... Schlumberger achieved the important results in 1927, but started to work on that in 1912, so we have many years of research. Before Schlumberger, we have the forgotten experience of the electrical mineral ore exploration of the British Williams, that they never actually tried to explore for oil. They tried to explore more for iron and other minerals. But unfortunately, even if the principle was similar to the one used by Schlumberger, they did file it because, as the colleague Vernon, Mr. Vernon in Great Britain, a geologist slash historian, Mr. Vernod found out that, expressed in several papers this theory, that they didn't properly recorded their data. They just played by ear. They didn't collect properly the information. They didn't write down the information. And that was a cause of the loss of data, and they never could, they never made to, let's say, refine the technology. So when we talk about information today, we talk about huge amounts of information. Not a coincidence, since many years, we have a worldwide association, is the Petroleum Professional Data Management, a learned society that is based in Canada, and they have representatives all over the world, and they group all the people working in the information and knowledge offices of companies, oil companies, petroleum companies, oil and gas companies, technical librarians, information officers, data scientists, data specialists, knowledge managers, all the people that are in charge to take care of giga and giga, terabytes of information. What the oil explorer was capable to store into some few megabytes in the 80s, today requires the same level of information, but more detailed, updated with today's technology, requires giga and gigabytes of information. And this is an important hot topic right now in information science, because you remember, I mean, I'm still affiliated with the School of Library Information Studies of the University of Oklahoma, directed by Professor Susan Burke. And we tried to establish a kind of link, a connection with the industry and the representatives of the Petroleum Professional Data Management Society. And we acknowledge that the library information science discipline is, yes, providing good information professionals. But then this information professional need to be hired and trained in the oil and gas companies. I mean, we have the data scientist that is capable to manage the data independently by the quality of the data. But when it comes to find a corporate librarian, a corporate information professional, knowledge professional, there is a kind of gap between the academy and the industry. Let's consider that one century before, the main and most important producer of knowledge in the oil industry was the scientist working in the industry, was the private consultant. Later was academy. Let's remember that we start to talk about degrees in oil geology and in oil engineering in the mid of the 1910s. Probably 1915 was the first degree in oil engineering from Morgantown, West Virginia, from Pittsburgh.
What do you think is the information going nowadays?
Well, for sure, it's going to be more and more specialized. I mean, oil geology was born as a branch of common natural, let's say, geology. Then was developed the geophysics, then the geochemistry, and then so long, this long increasing number of sub-disciplines. And then along the years, every discipline got this own committee or learned society, and started the specialization of the specialization. So let's consider, for example, now the new adventure of the postmodern petroleum industry, the unconventional petroleum industry that is coexisting with the conventional, with the modern oil industry, but this postmodern petroleum industry, this new paradigm called unconventional resources, focusing on tight oil, shale oil, tight gas, shale gas, is producing a new wave of literature. I mean, you can understand me very well when I talk you about proppants. Okay, let's talk with a specialist of proppants in the 1960s, 1970s, and let's talk with a specialist in proppants today. Let's invite tonight a specialist of proppants to dinner. I mean, how many things would say the specialist of proppants of 50 years ago in comparison of the huge, more extended development knowledge that gained the specialist in proppants today?
So
I think there is an abyss. There is an abyss.
So the implication is that you still think that the information today stays in industry?
Sure. The information stays in industry. We have to consider that the majority of the successful and important information knowledge produced in academy is funded by grants, endowments, whatever provided by the industry, and we have huge oil companies with important research centers that has nothing to envy to academic research centers. To conclude, yes, the future will be more specialized in information, the need for more information professionals, and there is the need for a better organization, a better understanding of the data, and data stewardship. The librarian, the info professional, must be capable to be the steward, to pass the specific, special, required data to the petroleum professional.
Thank you very much, Francesco. We were in conversation with Francesco Gerali, a 2019 PUGH Visiting Scholar at the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers at the History Center in Hoboken in New Jersey. Thank you very much, Francesco.
Thank you very much, Daniel. It was a pleasure to be with you today. Thanks.
This was Daniel Minizini, your inquisitive geology at Mini Geology. You can write me at minigeology@gmail.com. You can listen to this podcast again in the YouTube channel, minigeology.com. You can write me and suggest the next guest, or you can propose yourself to be the next guest. Thank you very much. Bye to everybody.
Histories of ages past, unenlightened shadows cast down through all eternity, the crying of humanity. 'Tis then when the hurdy-gurdy man comes singing songs of love. Then when the hurdy-gurdy man comes singing songs of love. Hurdy-gurdy, 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 hurdy-gurdy.